Good afternoon to all of you who have joined today. I'll be talking about approach to a case of previous stillbirth. So we all know that pregnancy is celebrated all over the world in different ways, whether it is the Western world as baby shower or in India as Godh Bharai. Sometimes, you know, this aspiration of a woman when she converts from a woman to a mother is just not met because the pregnancy that she has continued for 9 difficult months ends with a stillbirth. And by definition, WHO says that fetal death prior to complete expulsion from the mother, which is diagnosed by the absence of breathing or beating of the heart, pulsations of the umbilical cord, or movement of voluntary muscles. And for international comparisons, the WHO defines a stillbirth as a baby born with no signs of life at more than 28 weeks of gestation. Every year, there are 2.6 million stillbirths occurring, which fail to get noticed. 2 stillbirths occur every minute in the world. This is from Lancet, who published a whole series of papers in 2011 and then in 2016, highlighting the problem. And the saddest part for us is that 98% of these stillbirths, just, you know, these 2 will occur in the developed world. 98% of these babies will die in utero in countries like India or Nigeria. And 50% of these stillbirths will occur during labor because of poor quality of intrapartum care. So these are the 10 countries, which mainly includes India and Pakistan and rest of them, and Indonesia, rest of them are in Africa. So Southeast Asia, India, Pakistan, and Africa are the leading contributors to these statistics. Besides that, stillbirths are disposed of without any dignity. Affected mothers are subjected to stigma, holding them responsible for the stillbirth, and we wrongly believe that only few stillbirths are preventable. Determining the cause of the stillbirths aids maternal coping and improves counseling, helps predict the risk of recurrence, and plan treatment for subsequent pregnancies. And therefore, it is very important that we try to find out the cause. Identification of inherited syndromes also provides useful information for other family members if we do the genetic studies on the stillbirths. The management, I always say, starts with the workup of the previous index stillbirth, the previous pregnancy, and it mainly starts with a good history. I have based these, my slides and this session, on Lancet intrauterine fetal death stillbirth guidance from RCOG, the latest ACOG and SMFM 2020 guideline, and of up to date May 2021. The workup should be a teamwork, including an obstetrician, a neonatologist, a pathologist, and a geneticist. Maternal evaluation with history, examination, and investigations. Examination and photography of the stillbirth baby. Gross and histological examination of the placenta, the cord, and membranes. The placenta, it is said, is a very good record of all the intrauterine events that have occurred in the past 9 months. Lab investigations and cytogenetic studies of the fetus, as well as fetal autopsy. Maternal history and examination is very important. We should obtain and study the previous records that the woman has brought when the baby died. Rule out conditions associated with stillbirths, medical and obstetric history, establish the gestational age at the time of the stillbirth by the LMP, by maternal examination findings, with the help of previous ultrasounds and examination of the stillbirth, as many causes are going to lead to recurrence, and therefore the workup will vary accordingly. And a thorough history and examination is the best autopsy that we can do for such a case. Family history with a three-generation pedigree history of stillbirths, recurrent pregnancy loss and history of development delay or structural anomalies point to single gene disorders. So in such case where there's history of recurrent pregnancy loss with developmental delay or structural anomalies, better to go ahead with genetic studies. Consanguinity increases the possibility of autosomal recessive disorders. A tidal history of arrhythmias and sudden death, including SIDS, as prolonged QT syndrome may be associated with stillbirth with risk of recurrence in the next baby. Black lace twins, more compared to singletons, are more at risk of stillbirth. The sex of the baby, male babies are more at risk of stillbirth. And this was found in a study on more than 30 million births, that male babies are more at risk of stillbirth. Then when the extremes of maternal age, when the mother is too young or she's too old because of the comorbidities that may occur in older women, when she's unmarried and because of the social, emotional and lack of financial resources, she is more at risk of stillbirth. Then comorbid conditions we all know. Hypertension, especially pregnancy-induced hypertension, obesity, diabetes, renal disorders are very important conditions which can lead to stillbirth. Chronic hypertension increases the risk by 2 to 4 times in the next pregnancy. Then besides that, certain autoimmune diseases like SLE, renal disease, uncontrolled thyroid disease, intrahepatic cholestasis of pregnancy, which again tends to recur, is also associated with stillbirth. There are many obstetric complications in the present pregnancy which can lead to stillbirth. When there is IUGR, when there is placental abruption, chromosomal and genetic abnormalities, cord events, congenital anomalies, fetal-vaginal hemorrhage, uterine rupture, or previous cesarean with the uterine rupture, then certain drugs because they increase the chances of abruption, then and smoking which also increases the chances of abruption. And here both passive and active smoking is important. We tend to just ask whether the woman is addicted to tobacco or not, and we tend to ignore that she is living in a single room with her two kids and the husband is smoking 8 cigarettes throughout the night or 8 BDs throughout the night, exposing her to passive smoking. Then placental abnormalities, arrhythmias, fetal high drops, platelet alloimmunization, and most important, infections. And in our part of the world, it is malaria and many other infections. The season is now just, you know, prevalence of malaria is so high during these times. You all must be managing cases of stillbirths, patients coming with malaria and an intrauterine death. And the death occurs because of direct infection in the baby across the bloodstream, across the placenta, or it may be because of the hyperthermia, or because of the infection that occurred, which led to hyperthermia, which led to a congenital malformation, which led to the intrauterine death. Then there could be antiphospholipid syndrome is a very important cause of stillbirths. Inherited thrombophilias have not been associated with stillbirth. Assisted reproductive technology pregnancies, they are more at risk of stillbirth even after you remove the confounding factor of age, parity, and multifetal gestations, because they have more comorbidities probably, they have PCOs, they have undergone ICSI, which may cause direct damage to the gametes, and then because of very high incidence of multiple pregnancies. We all know that post-maturity and post-term pregnancies place the woman at risk of stillbirth, low socioeconomic status, advanced maternal age, essential hypertension, pregnancy-induced hypertension, antepartum hemorrhage, fetal growth restriction, they have all increased chances of stillbirth. And 18% of stillbirths occur in women in which these factors can be identified right at the beginning. So just by taking a good history on the first visit itself, you can decrease 1/5 of the stillbirths that are occurring. Previous history of stillbirth is the strongest factor for stillbirth recurrence. And many studies emphasize that not only documented FGR, but also a small for gestational age baby is also at increased risk of stillbirth, because basically small for gestational age baby is a proxy marker for FGR. Past obstetric history, previous stillbirth increases risk of recurrence compared with women with no history of stillbirth. Previous preterm delivery, IUGR or PIH increases the risk of stillbirth in subsequent pregnancies. The extremes of parity are associated with stillbirth. So those who are primary gravidas, they are more at risk, and those who are grand multiparas, they are also at risk of. Besides, placental abruption is one of the most important causes responsible for 5 to 10% cases, chromosomal and genetic abnormalities of the baby. That is, whenever there is an abnormal karyotype, which is seen in 6 to 13% of stillbirths, and more than 20% of cases with anatomical abnormalities, or when there is presence of IUGR. Then the trisomy 21, monosomy X, trisomy 18, and trisomy 13 are common abnormalities for stillbirth. Infection is also associated with, this is Western data, they say that is approximately in 1/5 of cases, infection may be associated with stillbirth. But in India or countries like us, where there's a very high incidence of pelvic infections, pre-labor rupture of membranes, poor intrapartum care, late reporting of women for antenatal care, during labor, all these put infection as a very important cause of stillbirths. And these are the different infections that have been implicated in stillbirths: cytomegalovirus, syphilis, parvovirus is an important cause, listeria, rubella, herpes simplex, toxoplasma, malaria. But malaria is one of the most important causes that, in my personal experience, I have seen, apart from another emerging infection, that is listeria. Then umbilical cord events also lead to stillbirths, like which are seen in 10% of stillbirths. Vasoprevia, cord entrapment, occlusion, leading to fetal hypoxia. And I'm sure so many of you have managed cases of cord prolapse or cord stricture with combi. These are important causes. The nuchal cord alone, please remember, is not a cause of death per se or an indication for cesarean section. Whenever the ultrasound reports that there is a cord around the neck, then it is only an indication that this woman should be managed more carefully during labor. It is not an indication of cesarean section. We do not want to increase the rate of cesarean section in the population, because we are all seeing the complications with which the women are coming, like placenta accreta, previa, cesarean scar pregnancy. Now the workup will include three types of investigations. The first would be the maternal lab investigations. Another would be the fetal cord membranes and placental evaluation in gross, and another would be the fetal labs, what investigations you would like to do on the baby itself once the stillbirth has occurred. So a complete blood count, a coagulation profile, and bile salts for obstetric cholestasis is important, and is important to send it as soon as possible, because the cholestasis will normalize within 48 hours, then you will not be able to get the cause of stillbirth. Then a Kleihauler test will tell you whether there has been a lethal fetomaternal hemorrhage, and also it will help you to decide those of anti-D. And it is recommended whether RH negative or positive, whether woman is delivering, because it is basically testing only the presence of fetal RBC. So it is telling you indirectly that hemorrhage has occurred, which is the cause of the stillbirth. Then maternal bacteriology is also important, especially when there is a fever or flu-like symptoms, or there's an offensive odor in liquor, or there's a pre-labor rupture of membranes. Then blood cultures in the mother, urine culture, vaginal swabs, cervical swabs, and placental swabs. We will discuss how to send a placental swab. Abnormal bacteriology is of doubtful significance in the presence of clinical or histological chorioamnionitis. So earlier when I used to send placenta for examination, in each case of stillbirth, I used to find that almost 50% or more than 50% cases, they were giving two types of reports. Either they were saying that there's evidence of chorioamnionitis, or they were telling, the pathologist was telling me that there's a risk, there's a evidence of uterine placental insufficiency. So sometimes there was no history of rupture of the membranes, and sometimes it was an elective cesarean, but the baby had undergone an elective cesarean because we could not, she was a case of previous 3-4 cesarean. Even then we found that the placental histology showed the presence of infection. So later on when I read up, I found that it was the transplacental transmission of infection, which was cause of the stillbirth, and infections remain the leading cause of stillbirth, especially in our part of the world. Then you may send viral screen if you suspect syphilis and tropical infections, that is especially malaria and listeria in our part of the world. Then hemoglobin A1C would tell you better, because once the woman has gestational diabetes and stillbirth has occurred, her sugar will normalize very fast. So you may not be able to detect GDM even when it was there. So hemoglobin A1C would be a better option. Then TSH also is very important for ruling out occult maternal thyroid disease. Then antiphosphate screen is very important. It is always indicated in unexplained stillbirth or stillbirth associated with FGR or PIH with severe features. Most tests are unaffected by pregnancy. If abnormal, you may repeat after 6 weeks, or you may diagnose her as antiphospholipid syndrome and treat her accordingly in the next pregnancy. It is a lupus anticoagulant and anticardiolipin antibody, which is more important than the antiphospholipid antibody for these cases. Inherited thrombophobias, the recommendation is that they are not associated with stillbirth and do not test for inherited thrombophobias unless you're wasting the patient's money and increasing your workload of interpreting a particular test. Parental karyotype. Now, what studies should be done on the baby, on the mother, the parents? So whenever you are suspecting parental mosaicism, fetal unbalance translocation, fetal genetic testing fails, but the history is suggestive of aneuploidy or fetal abnormality is there on postmortem, or there is a previous unexplained stillbirth or recurrent pregnancy loss, all these are good candidates for genetic parental karyotype. The next is the study or evaluation of the fetus itself, the cord, the membranes, and the placental evaluation. So it is a must for all cases of stillbirth that you send the placenta for histopathology and you do a proper examination. The inclusion of placental histology in classification of stillbirth reduces the number of stillbirths classified as unexplained. In women who decline invasive testing, a portion of the placenta, an umbilical cord segment, or internal fetal tissue can be sent for genetic analysis. Gross examination of the placenta, diagnosis, gross and microscopic, both are important, and it is able to diagnose fetal infections 30% of the cases. Record the weight, the retroplacental clots. It is most informative as placental insufficiency and infection are commonest causes, causative findings. Chorionicity and vascular communications in twins can also be detected. Then placental culture and peeling the amnion and chorion and swabbing this surface using a sterile technique, you can send the investigations. Send both aerobic and anaerobic cultures from the placenta and the fetal lung if you find that there is a high drops. Viral infections can be diagnosed on histopath, so there is no need of doing that. Molecular studies of Coxsackie virus if you suspect that there is a myocarditis on histology. Umbilical cord, do a gross and microscopic, the number, the length, whether it's a short or a long or a single umbilical cordy artery, all that you have to note down. Then the diameter, the coiling, the entanglement, the edema. But please remember, if you find a true knot, then send it for histopathology only when there is histopathological evidence, then only you can say that it is related to the cord accident. Then you have to examine the stillborn baby, the weight, the circumference, the length, the foot length, the gestational age, frontal and profile pictures of the baby should be taken and should be kept with the parents, and they should be told to preserve those pictures, because sometimes when all investigations are inconclusive, you may want to talk to a geneticist in order to discuss which genetic tests are required for this particular baby. Photographs of the nails with the nails can exclude many syndromes. Note any dysmorphic features, any presence of high drops or FGR, and documentation of all these findings is very important for the next pregnancy or further investigations. Evaluation of a stillbirth should include fetal autopsy, gross and histological examination of the placenta, umbilical cord and membranes, and genetic evaluation. Highest diagnostic yield of all investigations along with placental histopathology is with fetal autopsy. So if the patient is agreeing to it and she has no religious or inhibitions to that or reservations to that, please advise her, counsel her for a fetal autopsy. 30-45%, especially in cases of dysmorphic features, IUGR or anomalies or high drops, you'll be able to diagnose. Consent is a difficult part, like I told you, and due to concern of disfigurement, because of ethical issues in the context of social, cultural, and religious backgrounds of the patient. For example, in Muslims, it is discouraged. Fetal autopsy is discouraged. Partial autopsy and imaging, when patient refuses fetal autopsy, use less invasive methods, transcutaneous tissue biopsy, body cavity aspiration, blood from the heart, gross examination and photography, imaging with x-rays, ultrasound, CT scan, and MRI. So all these you can do, and this is known as partial autopsy or imaging autopsy if the woman or the parents refuse the actual autopsy of the stillborn because of the disfigurement involved or because of some religious inhibitions. So these are different ways in which you can do the workup, continue with the workup of the baby. Then the guidelines for fetal autopsy, you need to establish the gestational age and estimate the interval of the death, what all features you should know. So all pathologists should be trained in doing fetal autopsy and in studying the placenta in a case of stillbirth. And if any one of you are interested in that, you can just send me a message. If any of the pathologists are here who have logged in, or if any of the gynecologists or obstetricians are there who would like their pathologist friends to be trained in that, then we are going to hold online workshops for them, what to look for and how to do the autopsy and the placental histopathology in a case of stillbirth. So not all pathologists are trained in that. Then you have x-rays, then which is another method of knowing. You can find some, pointers towards the diagnosis. Then ultrasound, CT scan, MRI can also be used in the same way in the baby if they have refused the autopsy. Then certain studies on the baby can be done. You can do a simple metabolic study by a heel prick test, which will from the baby, or you can do genetic studies on the baby if the baby is FGR or if the baby looks abnormal. Then, or the baby's the morphology of the baby is fitting into some particular syndrome, then you have to investigate accordingly. And also whenever there is high drops, there is any obvious anatomical abnormality, then you need to do the genetic studies. How do you collect the sample for karyotyping? That is very important. Why? Because the baby may be dead, the baby is dead, it may be, there may be a maceration, she may be delivering an IUD after a whole week of intrauterine death. So you have to be very careful how you collect the sample, otherwise the yield is not going to be very good. Only 50% of the cell culture will be able to cells will be cultured, and there'll be failure in 50% of the cases. So do not take any specimen from the skin. It is the cartilage from the costochondral junction or the patella. Please remember, it is the cartilage from the costochondral junction or the patellar bone of the baby, and about 1 to 1.5 centimeters is sent in a sterile linear lactate. Do not send it in formalin. Why sterile linear lactate? Because they are going to grow these cells to find out the karyotype. Then chromosomal microarray is something more advanced. It will tell you the genetic problem even at the level of the gene, and then also, but it is not recommended currently because it is a very costly investigation. Then most important is that you go ahead and try to have a clinical scenario based, you know, genetic study. So for that, you will need to preserve all the documentation of the morphology of the baby, the sonography of the baby, all the intrauterine events that have occurred, and then send all this clinical picture and the picture of the baby to the geneticist, and then they will try to find it into certain syndrome, and maybe they will say, look here, look, find out, try to do this particular genetic study. So that will try to decrease the cost for the patient. Now, what is the challenge? You have so many tests, and even after, you know, all this discussion for the past 25 minutes, I think I might have confused you more rather than tried to help you. So you don't know where to go from where to start. So let's see a quick revision. Appropriate history and physical findings should be included in the requisition sent to the lab to assist the lab personnel to interpret cytogenetic studies. A thorough maternal history should be taken to look for known conditions or symptoms suggestive of those that are associated with stillbirth. Healthcare providers should weigh the risk and benefits of each investigation, each strategy in a given clinical scenario, and consider available institutional expertise. Like I told you that, try to train your pathologist to look for the relevant features in these placenta or to learn how to do a proper autopsy. Shared decision making plays an important role in determining the optimal method of delivery in the setting of fetal demise. What and how many maternal tests should be recommended to identify the cause of IUFD? So many tests I have talked about. So which one to order? So you can order all of them and then go back and take a holiday. And then when you come back, the patient will be sitting with you and you have to do so much work. So always it has to be a proper history and clinical examination, and then targeted investigations in a stepwise manner. Start with the common causes. Then if you do not find anything, go to the next step and then the next step. But if you think you have taken a good history and examination, you'll be able to order a particular costly investigation at the first go itself. So there's some protocol, some workup has to be there in your mind. There is no worldwide consensus as to when cytogenetic, biochemical, and molecular studies or viral cultures are indicated. Follow a decision tree to decide whether to send tissue for genetic studies or tissue for other special studies. So this is a very cluttered chart, but this is something very clear. If you have a stillbirth, try to look at the history and examine, do the history and the examination. And if you find no clues at all, kuch nahi mila aapko history examination mein, then you have to do a genetic testing, antiphospholipid profile, fetal maternal hemorrhage testing, and other testing as indicated. If you have zeroed in on fetal growth restriction or hypertensive disorders, you may do a genetic testing, antiphospholipid antibody, fetal hemorrhage, and other testing as indicated. If there is a suspected fetal anomaly, then again genetic testing, because whenever there is FGR, then there may be some genetic anomaly as well in the baby. If there is anomaly, then you have to do the genetic testing and other testing if required. If it is an intrapartum stillbirth, then you may require an antiphospholipid testing, a fetal maternal hemorrhage testing, and other testing as indicated. So look here, you have a different type of protocol for intrapartum stillbirths. For others, if there is a preterm labor, if there is a chorioamnionitis, if there is a preterm pre-labor rupture of membranes, or any other clinical scenario, then depending on your clinical suspicion, you need to confirm that whether this was the particular cause. But what is all this pointing to? This one, this one, this one, every type of stillbirth, it is pointing finally to fetal autopsy and placental pathology. So this is a very important, you know, investigation which will help you in arrive at a diagnosis almost 50% of the cases. Then you may accordingly go ahead with the genetic studies. Test should be directed to identify only scientifically proven causes of late intrauterine fetal death. Clinical workup, a detailed history and examination will help in minimizing the number of investigations. Start with the common causes, use a stepwise approach, and there's one concept of a rainbow clinic. And this rainbow clinic is working up a patient with previous IUFD and trying to give them a positive, just like a rainbow, some positivity to them. And this will be starting very soon from the Silver Society of India, which has been recently formed. So now the summary, I would just like to show you a few photographs so that you remember with the help of these photographs, what does it tell you? It tells you that it has to be a very balanced evidence-based approach. Do not order all investigations for all patients. Do it on the basis of the clinical scenario for which you need to do the detailed history and a detailed examination and detailed labs of the woman. Always when she's coming to you in prevention of stillbirth, it is very important that you listen to the woman. She's trying to tell you something, the movement is not okay. You get an ultrasound done. She says again, the movement is not, the Manning score is 10 by 10. Then you get a CTG done. Again, the CTG is perfectly fine, but she keeps on saying, look here, I don't think so, my baby's all right. So the dictum, the rule is that if all investigations say that nothing is wrong, but the mother says that something is wrong, then something may be wrong. So listen to her, whatever she's saying, and examine her very carefully during the antenatal period. So this is what I was saying. If all investigations say nothing is wrong, but the patient says something is wrong, then something is wrong because she is the one who's with her baby 24/7. Okay. Preventing an IFD is an obstetric responsibility. Its management has a structured format and its proper implementation will ensure that medicine remains a noble and compassionate art, that is antenatal care, the best is tender loving care. When you do not find any cause, just go ahead with tender loving care. Because at the heart of it all, what matters most is who has touched our lives and whose lives we have touched. Sometimes in spite of doing everything for the patient, you end up with a intrauterine fetal death. The patient is blaming you or herself or anybody. You are yourself feeling very bad. It is okay not to be okay after the death of the baby, whether it is the baby's parents or whether it is the care provider. So if you feel that way, take help. And I want to announce that we have established the Stillbirth Society of India. We have registered it and affiliated it to International Stillbirth Alliance. And if you are interested, please contact me and I'll put my phone number in the chat box once I finish this talk. You can contact me if you want to be a member and you have to work towards this or you want to establish a rainbow clinic in your city. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for your wonderful lecture session. Now, I would request to all the doctors, if you have any query, any patient case that you want to discuss with ma'am, you can share it in the chat or Q&A box, or you can raise your hand. Ma'am, we have received a query from Dr. Wangkhere for no structural or chromosomal abbreviation. How important is QT syndrome in sudden stillbirth?
Sorry?
Yes, sure, ma'am. For no structural or chromosomal abbreviation, how important is QT syndrome in sudden stillbirth? Q and T is QT
syndrome. QT syndrome only when there is evidence of myocarditis on autopsy, then it is to be investigated. That is the recommendation.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Next query is there any role of ecosperin in third trimester in recurrent pregnancy loss?
In third trimester?
Yes, ma'am, third trimester.
So whenever you are giving ecosperin, you are giving it around six, after at least, the establishment of the cardiac activity. So I'm not aware of any such protocol. I don't think so. If you're giving it at third trimester, it is going to make much of a difference. It is not part of any of the guidelines, whether it is RCUG, ACUG, SMFM, or up to date.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much. Next query is from Dr. Shikha Jain. She has two queries. What investigation are must before induction of IUD, and why IUD cases increases in COVID time?
Okay, so one of the reasons what we found why IUD increased in our facility was because the patients were not coming for antenatal care. So, and there was a lockdown, or maybe they did not have enough money. They could not afford that antenatal care. And also because everybody was not, the delivery of the RMCH services was not up to the mark. So that was one of the reasons patients were coming to us directly as pregnancy-induced hypertension or PPH or APH and with severe anemia. So one of the reasons was that. But we did see a marked increase in pregnancy-induced hypertension. So I just went through literature. I also found that many people have reported that with during COVID times, the incidence increased. And another query was, what are the investigations that you should do if you start induction? So one is that you need to find out the important causes which may affect the patient currently. Maybe if she's hypertensive still, or she's a diabetic and it is not controlled. So it is all that will have an effect on the mother. But you have to rule out the accidental hemorrhage. But important is that you do the coagulation profile. But what happens is that you see maximum cases of DIC, you see in obstetric cases. But for IUD or for a missed abortion, it is usually a chronic type of coagulation derangement that occurs, and it takes 1 to 3 weeks to develop. So if it's a recent IUD, then you are not much at risk. But yes, if she's coming to you after 3 weeks, it is better to get a coagulation profile before you go ahead.